Sure, you have brought us again to the what? Young saints feeling. I have become young. Now we come to verses 4 through 10. How about the first six rules of this section? Read to us these seven verses, 4 through 10.
Brothers, beloved by God, your selection, because our gospel did not come to you in word only, but also in power, and in the Holy Spirit, and in much assurance, even as you know what kind of men we were among you for your sake, and you became imitators of us and of the Lord, having accepted the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Spirit, so that you became a pattern to all those who believe in Macedonia and in Achaia. For from you the word of the Lord has sounded out, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but in every place your faith toward God has gone out, so that we have no need to speak anything. For they themselves report concerning us what manner of entrance we had to you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve a living and true God, and to wait for his Son from the heavens, whom he raised from among the dead, Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath which is coming.
Thank you. The more you read this book, the more you realize that it is really written to the young believers. The way Paul talks in this book is altogether so young. Firstly, he says, we know your election. This means the apostle knows that the Thessalonians are God's selected people, God's chosen people. Their selection was made manifest to such an extent that the apostles have the assurance that they have been selected by God. And such a thing as selection made manifest by what? By the believer's reaction to the gospel. How do you know that you have been selected? If you reject the gospel, and that is a sign of your not being selected. If you reject, that means what? You indicate that you are not selected by God. But if you accept the gospel willingly in a positive way, and this kind of acceptance is a sign, it's a symbol that you surely have been selected by God. God selected you before the foundation of the world in eternity. Now in time, he comes to you in the preaching of the gospel. Now, it depends upon your reaction. If your reaction is passive, that is a passive sign. If your reaction is negative, that is a negative sign. The apostles got to know that these Thessalonians were selected by God. By what? By their quick and willing acceptance of the gospel in a positive way. See, no doubt, this is a kind of talk to the young believers. I call this a kind of young talk. Now we have to learn, right? In the testing, we have heard that in preaching gospel, we have to bring people into the realization of the organic union. Now, here's another point, that is, we must help the new beginners to know they're being selected by God. This is a foundation laid my, laid what? Laid in eternity. Such a foundation laid in eternity. The foundation of our salvation is not laid only in this age, in time, but it was laid in eternity. It was based there selection. God saved us. And it is based upon that foundation that the Spirit moves us to believe. The Spirit's move is based upon the foundation laid in eternity. And that foundation was just God's eternal selection. See, we must do our best to help the new beginners to know this selection as the eternal foundation. If before tonight, you young ones never got to know this, I'd like to impress you that you all have to realize that in eternity past, you have been selected. And you could be here tonight. It's a positive sign of your eternal selection. Paul says, knowing, brothers, your selection, because we know this, so we have the boldness to say the following to you. The following is this, because our gospel did not come to you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit. And in much assurance, power, Holy Spirit, and assurance. This is also a lesson that we all have to learn. To preach the gospel, we must preach it in power. And in the Holy Spirit, and in much assurance. When we preach, we have the assurance, this is the saving gospel, and this gospel we preach will save people. We must have the assurance. I tell you, before the sinners believe in the gospel, we must believe it first. We must believe that the gospel will save people. When you preach, many times, you shouldn't look at the face of the opposers. You see? The face of the opposers may what? Reduce your faith. You have to look at the gospel. Don't look at the opposing faces. Don't believe the opposing faces. All those faces are lies. You must have the assurance that God, the gospel you preach surely will save the opposers. Even as you know, what kind of men we were among you for your sake. This is important. You see, the writing in this verse, to my opinion, is altogether not logic. Not logic. How could you match? Or how could you put power, the Holy Spirit, with what manner? What kind of man we live. Yet Paul puts these two sides together. If you preach the gospel in power, in the Holy Spirit, and in much assurance, you must have a kind of a life to match it. You must have a manner in manner of your life to match the power, the Holy Spirit, and the assurance. A loose person, a led person, a person who does not live Christ can never preach the gospel in power, in the Holy Spirit, and in much assurance. First of all, you must live Christ. You must have a kind of manner of life. The manner of your life must match the power, the Holy Spirit, and the much assurance. In other words, power and the Holy Spirit would only go along with your manner of life. If you don't have that manner of life, the power and the Holy Spirit would not go along, because your manner of life doesn't match the power and the Holy Spirit. Then, verse 6, and you became imitators of us. The strange thing is this. Listen. Firstly, the sinners or the new believers, they become imitators of you. Then they become the imitators of the Lord. You must be a kind pattern. You must be a kind model. People don't see the Lord first. They see you first. If you are not good for people to look at, it'd be hard for people to look at the Lord. So you are the representative. You represent the Lord. So you must be some pattern. Then people can imitate you, and through you, people can imitate the Lord. This is clear. Well, you could see this is all a talk to the new believers, right? This is a young talk. A talk to the young believers. Having accepted the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Spirit. Then, so that you become a pattern to all those who believe in Macedonia and Achaia. They imitate the pattern, and then they become the pattern. Right? They become the pattern. These new believers, young converts, they become patterns in those two provinces. Macedonia was a province. Achaia was a southern province. You see, these brothers and sisters all become the pattern of all the believers in those two Roman provinces. For from you the word of the Lord has sounded out. Not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but in every place your faith toward God has gone out, so that we have no need to speak anything. Very good. The subtitle here says, this message is on the origination of a holy life for the church life. This book is on a holy life for the church life. And the first message gives you the structure of such a life. And the structure was that the work of faith, the labor of love, and the endurance of hope are the three main structures of such a holy life for the church life. In other words, the holy life for the church life is constructed with the faith work and the love labor and the hope's endurance. That is the structure. We have seen it. And we have covered so much, even the testing. Now we come to origination. How such a life was originated? It was originated by the preaching of the word. Then, by the acceptance of such a preached word. So we all have to see, to help the new beginners, we must present them an amount of proper word, the word of God. We must present an amount of word of God to them in what? In power, in the Holy Spirit, in much assurance, with or matched with our manner of life. Then surely they will accept this word and they will imitate us. They will follow us to follow the Lord. And they will become pattern to other believers. So it is by this way that a holy life for the church life has been originated. This is the origin. Now we must take care of the last two verses of such a life. These last two verses show us the details of such a life. Verse 9 says, "For they themselves report concerning us what manner of entrance we had to you." Again, you see, the apostle stresses the manner of life, the lived. And how you, listen, these are the detailed contents of such a holy life for the church life. Number one, how you turn to God from idols. How you turn to God from idols. Number two, to serve a living and true God. And number three, and to wait for his Son from the heavens, whom he raised from among the dead, Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath which is coming. These three items are the detailed living of such a life, which is a holy life for the church life. Three things: turn to God from the idols, serve the living and true God, wait for the Son of God to come back from the heavens. And tonight, we need to dwell upon these three detailed items a little bit. You have to realize, dear saints, the Christian life is a life with the first characteristic, that is to turn yourself to God from the idols. Some people think that they are atheists. They don't believe any God, and they don't worship God. They thought so. Actually, they all worship something. No human being doesn't worship anything. Because, like your physical body, it has a stomach. How could you have a stomach without eating? It's impossible. As long as you live, you eat, because you have a stomach. Which man, there's another stomach, a spiritual stomach. That is our spirit. We have a spirit within us. Every human being has a spirit. And this spirit is just for worshiping God. God created a spirit to worship Him, to contact Him, to receive Him, to keep Him, to contain Him, even to express Him. Our spirit was purposely created by God, just like our stomach. God created us a stomach. So every day, right? Every day we are hungry. And we are hungry 3 times a day, right? In the morning, noon time, then evening time. I don't know, how about you? I must eat something in the morning, and I must eat something at noon time, and I must eat something at evening time, because if I don't, I just feel hungry. How about you? Don't you feel hungry? Right? Why you feel hungry? You say you don't believe in food. You say you don't care for food. But you eat more than others. Right? The atheists, I tell you, they worship something. All human races, not an exception, ancient, new, modern, I tell you, all human races worship. No race on this earth in human history doesn't worship. Whether you worship the wrong God, or you worship the right God, whether you worship properly, or you worship wrongly, that is another question. But you all worship, whether you eat the right food, or you eat the wrong food. Whether you eat food to nourish you or to kill you, that is another thing. But anyhow, I tell you, all eat, right? No one doesn't eat. The atheists, they worship themselves. Themselves are their God. See? And in the Bible, we are told even some people's belly is their God. They just worship their belly. Belly, right? So no one in the human race doesn't worship. Some worships education. Some worships a fame, a good name. Some worships possession. So lots of idols. Only one God, one object of worship is not an idol, but the real God. That's God Himself. Beside God Himself, whatever, a person, a matter, a thing, any person, anyone, other than God, if you worship, that is an idol. And lots of idols. When I was in my youth, I heard a lot talk about the Americans. That was in China. And these kind of talks were all made by the American missionaries. And the American missionaries gave us a kind of impression that all the Americans are wonderful people. Marvelous. And that was the reason from my youth I began to love America. And the love of America was imparted into me. It was so into me. I mean it. It was infused into me by the American missionaries. So I thought all the Americans don't have idols. In China, lots of idols. Oh, America, America, beautiful America. Must be a clean land. It is not only a free land, but also a clean land without idols. Okay. I came to this country, not in my youth. I came to the country in my old age. The more I stay in this country, the more I found out, more idols. More idols. The idols in China are quite manifested, outward. The idols in U.S. are quite hidden, concealed. Am I right? My, the Americans, they are the real lovers. When they love something, they mean it. When they love dancing, they mean it. They go dancing. Right? And in China, I never saw such an intensive dancing as in America. I never saw such an intensive fishing. When the Americans go fishing, they mean it. Right? Fishing is also an idol. Dancing is an idol. My, the entertainment. USA, it is altogether right for us to say USA is a country of entertainment. Oh, Friday night, Saturday night, what are they doing? All kinds of pleasures, all kinds of entertainment. When they go to entertainment, they go crazy. They even go forgetting their names. Am I right? What are these? Idols. They worship idols. The Lord's Day was ordained by God for His people to worship Him. Then, Maya, in the entire world, this so-called Sunday is a day of worshiping idols. You just consider today on this earth how many real worshippers of the true God on this earth. Not so many as the worshippers of entertainment, idols. We think the gospel is to turn people from sin into God. But Paul's preaching of the gospel is to turn people from the idols. Just to turn people from sin to God is not sufficient. This is a poor and weak preaching. A stronger preaching is not only to turn people from sin, but also from idols. It's easy to turn people from sin, but not so easy to turn people from idols. Am I right? What is the beginning of the Christian life? The beginning of the Christian life is to turn from idols. I tell you, if you would turn from idols, surely sin is gone. sin, you know what? Sin is behind the idols. In the entertainment, a lot of sins there. In dancing, it's sin. In gambling, it's sin. In fishing, in drinking, in smoking, in all these entertainments, what are there? Sins. Right? If you don't worship an idol, surely you don't sin. Am I right? It's hard for you not to sin. Well, you are worshiping idols. Idols, strictly speaking, are just parts of the devil. Demons, they are demons. Every idol at least has one demon behind the scene. In all the entertainments, dancing, amusements, pleasures, I tell you, at least one demon is behind the scene. Too many times, too many demons behind the scene. So, the Christian life is a life that begins from turning to God from the idols. I just say this much. I must stress a little bit, even tonight, many of us still need further turn from some idols unto God. If we still want something other than God, I tell you, that something is an idol. Anything other than God that distracts us, that draws our attention, that is an idol. So what? So even today, even tonight, many of us still need further turn to God from our idols. The Christian life must bear such a first characteristic. The Christian life is a pure life without idols. We must bear such a characteristic that our life is pure from any kind of idols. Then, to serve the living and true God. Here, it mentions living first. For us to serve a true God is easy. It is even easier. Well, listen, we need to serve a living God. To you, God must be so living, not only in the heavens, but in your daily life. God must be so living in you. God must be so living in your speaking, in your acting, in your daily walk, in every aspect of your daily life. How could you prove that God is living? By your daily life. If God is not so living, you would never live a life like what you are living. Your present living is a testimony that the very God whom you serve is living. He is living in you. He controls you. He directs you. He deals with you. He wouldn't let you go in many things. He corrects you. He adjusts you, right? God is living. He's living in the heavens. That kind of living has much to do with the angels. Nothing to do with you. But he's living in you. Nothing to do with the angels. It's altogether something to do with you. He's living in you. He's living because he controls you. He directs you. He directs you even your small things. Even your thinking. In your motive. Right? In everything. He's so living. How could you prove to people, to relatives, cousins, in-laws, neighbors, friends, how could you prove to people that your God is living? By your daily walk. You live in a way. You live in a way that you are under the control, under the direction, under the correction of a living God. An idol never controls you. Right? You can gambling before the idol. You can steal people before the idol. The idol. Right? Can you steal people before a living God? If your God is living, how could you steal people? If your God is living, how could you lie? If God is living in you, he would never allow you to lie. To serve a living God. This is the second characteristic of a Christian life. We must live a life that bears the testimony that the very God we worship and we serve is living. And he's living in my detailed daily life. Amen. This is different from today's Christianity. In Manila, some of the saints there, most of them are sisters, a few brothers, came from Manila. You know, 20 years ago, I was with you every year for quite a time. Ah, that really shocked me. I saw so many Catholics in Manila. You know what they did? They stole people. They stole people even in the casino. Then they have a day. I forgot the name. A day for them to repent. And on that day, they did out of repentance. The strange thing that shocked me was that right after their repentance, they went out to steal, to rob. The sisters in Manila, they dare not to take a kind of a car carelessly. They have to take off their watches. They have to take off a lot of things. Otherwise, well, they are going on in the car, right away someone comes to rob the watch. Yet, after this kind of robbing, they went to Misa, to the Catholic Church. To participate in the Holy Communion. what can God to worship? Surely dead God. Their God is not living. Right? How about your God? The proper Christian should live a life that bears the testimony. Their God is living. Their God is living. Why I couldn't do this right now? Because my God is living. He is right now living in me. Why I couldn't say such a thing? I couldn't say certain thing to you using certain words. Why? Because my God right now is living in me. I worship, I serve a living God who is living not only in the heavens, but also in me. Oh, turn to God from the idols to serve the living and true God. When God is living, no doubt he is true. Right? This is number two. The number three, we, the Christians, must live a life that always declares to people, our hope is not on this earth. Our hope is not in this age. Our hope is in the coming Lord. Our hope is in him. And our future is in him. On this earth, we have no destination. On this earth, we don't even have any destiny. We don't have any future. Our future, our destiny, our destination, all together focused in him. And he's coming. He's coming. He will be our hope. He will be our future. He will be our destination. Where are you going? I'm going to the Lord. What's your destiny? My destiny is to meet him. You see? You know, the world people, their kind of living always gives people the impression that their future is on this earth. Their destination is today. And their destiny is today. Their hope is today. Am I right? Their future is all together wrapped with this earth. But our future is not wrapped with this earth. Our future is all focused on him. And he's coming. We are waiting for the Son of God from the heavens. We have no hope on this earth. We have no destination on this earth. And we have even no destiny in this age. These are the genuine Christians. The genuine Christians have nothing other than God. They have no idols. And they live alive to testify that their God is living. Their God is living in their daily life. And they always declare by their way of living that they had no hope on this earth. On this earth, nowhere to go. No destiny. No destination. No future. Their everything is focused on the coming one. They are waiting for such a one to come. I think, brothers, I just give you this much tonight. Then, now some of you are working with the young believers, the new converts. I hope that you would pray and see something from this book and learn how to help the new beginners, the young converts. Brother Rob told us that we were saved there in some place. We were never helped in this way, right? I think tonight many of us have pick up something to make up your proper Christian life. Even some maybe here who have been in the recovery for years, yet still you hold on to some idols. You still hold on to some things other than God. And your daily life doesn't testify that the very God you serve is living. Living right now. He's not living because you are so free. You are so loose. Right? And you're doing a lot of things without any adjustment. This is a kind of a negative testimony that your God is not so living. If he's living, why you are so loose? Why you are not under his control? Why you are not his correction? Right? Why you are not under his correction? If he's living, he corrects you. He would not let you be so loose, right? So we all need to pick up some lesson to make up our Christian life. And I do believe we might be all short of a kind of waiting spirit. We need to have a spirit that is waiting for his coming back. Our life doesn't declare this. And our life doesn't bear a testimony with the atmosphere that we are waiting for his coming back. The proper life for the church life is such a life without idols, a life that testifies your God is living, and a life that is waiting for his coming back. Please. Tell me, this can talk isn't a can talk to the young believers? And tonight I'm talking to young believers. I'm talking to new converts, right? Okay, now I think the meeting should go to the central section. Tonight the central section is really busy. Am I right? Or what? Well, the second part of the second section has never been so much involved. How about you pick up the burden to share something? I mean the second part of the second section. Right from the middle of the section. You brothers, most of you are part-timers. Mostly you were not with us in the day, but anyhow, in the night, you are here. So I'd like you to bear some burden to share something with us along this kind of a new beginner's Christian life, for the church life.